Well, so first of all, let me just thank Town Hall for having me back, and thank you, Paul, for doing this conversation. So the way I see it is that this phenomenon of big philanthropy, all these new donors arriving with tremendous amounts of money, is very much a natural outgrowth of this second Gilded Age in which we've been living, which really started in the 1980s. And since then, there's been this dramatic increase of wealth in the hands of that top 1% that we hear so much about. And just to give you a couple statistics to get a sense of the scope of how much wealth has been created. So in 1982, the Forbes 400 list was published for the first time, and it had exactly 13 billionaires on it. The richest person on the list had $2 billion, and to get on the list, you only needed $80 million. That was the entry. That was the entry level fee or net worth to get on the list. Recently, the Forbes 400 published its 2017 list. To get on this time, you need $1.7 billion. A lot of billionaires didn't even make the cut. And the richest person on the list, Bill Gates, is worth $86 billion. And the Forbes 400 has a combined net worth of $2.5 trillion, which is more than the combined assets of the bottom 60% of US households. The number of people with the resources to engage in large-scale philanthropy has just exponentially increased. And it's a big difference from that first Gilded Age, which did produce a number of very wealthy people, Rockefeller, Carnegie, J.P. Morgan, but nothing on the scale that we've seen in this era. So when people are that wealthy, I mean, what do you do with that kind of money? You don't want to leave it to your kids. You don't want to. Many of them, but these people don't want the government. Don't want it to go to the estate taxes. And so philanthropy for the richest of the rich is really the only option. And not surprisingly, about 150 billionaires have now signed this giving pledge that Warren Buffett and Bill Gates developed in 2010. And many others who haven't signed the giving pledge nevertheless plan to give away most of their wealth. Somebody like George Soros, who's not signed the giving pledge, but his entire assets of $26 billion are going to go to philanthropy. And beyond and below those billionaires, there's also just numerous people with significant assets. That kind of a statistic that really blew my mind was that 70,000 U.S. households have assets of at least $30 million. 70,000 households with assets of at least $30 million, which does not include, by the way, their real estate holdings. That's just like money, that's liquid assets, which is plenty of wealth to engage in philanthropy, which explains, you know, why we're seeing so many donors appearing right now.
Good, great. So one thing I meant to do at the start, just to give us a sense of sort of also who's in the room, is, so just real quick by show of hands, how many billionaires do we have? And now, forget it. So how many folks here say maybe work for a nonprofit? Okay. How many folks work at a funder, foundation, work for a philanthropist? Okay. And then other folks sort of like interested, concerned, active citizens? And then all other? Okay. All right. That just sort of helps to have a feel of who's in the room. So what sort of distinguishes these folks? What sort of strategies are they using to advance their goals? And is it any different than, I remember we started SVP, sometimes I felt to myself, folks said, oh, gee, venture philanthropy is so new, and yet you looked at how Carnegie and Rockefeller did some of what they did, and it wasn't all that much different. Are folks today doing different things? Are they using different strategies? What are they using, and how is it different?
When did you start SVP?
1999. 98.
Well, a couple things have changed. So when I first started looking at philanthropy back in the 1990s, it was a field very much dominated by institutional players. Foundations were the major kind of people who or institutions that were sort of setting the tone and driving the action, and that has really shifted dramatically with the arrival of all these living donors. And You want to be careful about generalizing about these new philanthropists because they're very heterogeneous, as I discovered in my book. You know, we hear so much about the tech philanthropists. You know, you start to imagine that the face of the new philanthropist is like a 34-year-old techie who made their money in Silicon Valley, but that's not necessarily the case. There's a lot of older philanthropists who've made their fortunes over decades who are now turning to large-scale giving, many who've made their money in the old, so-called old economy. The average age, by the way, of somebody on the Forbes 400 list is 64. But nevertheless, there are some things that distinguish some of these new, particularly these new younger donors. One, they don't want to do the old model of you just wait. You make the money and then you give it away. Many of them want to proceed in this sort of more integrated fashion. They want to make money, they want to give money away, they want to think about how their businesses also contribute to social good. They don't compartmentalize the way some of the earlier philanthropists might have. Another characteristic is many of them, especially the ones coming out of the tech sector, are quite interested in finding that big a disruptive idea to drive systemic change. The old model of charitable giving, you write checks to big institutions and let them do what they will with the money, has been increasingly giving way to this desire to drive systemic change, to play a very hands-on role. It's not just about writing checks. And so those are, and by the way, quite a few of them are not creating the traditional foundation, the freestanding institution that has its staff. A lot of them, because they're still busy with their day jobs, they're turning to intermediaries to help them do their giving. They're donating through community foundations or through donor-advised funds, or they're much more likely to have a kind of decentralized model of they'll keep their money in a donor-advised fund, they'll have some consultants that help them. They want to remain nimble. They don't want to be locked down in this whole traditional foundation.
Okay. So the subtitle of your book is Wealth, Power, and Philanthropy in a New Gilded Age. You told us about their wealth. What can you tell us about their power?
They have a lot of it. and more. And a key point kind of I drive home in my book is that, so economic inequality has, in the last three decades, increasingly translated into growing levels of civic and political inequality. And we're most familiar with this phenomenon when it comes to the electoral realm. We know that wealthy people have increasingly become dominant players in who gets elected, as, you know, with tremendous amounts of money going to super PACs, with traditional political parties giving way to a system more that revolves around these super donors. What I suggest in my book is that philanthropic dollars have increasingly been harnessed to drive change in the public policy arena, and that this money can be just as effective, if not more effective, than political giving or money that goes for lobbying, because often it's helping shape the agenda. And I have a chapter, for example, in the book called Grand Masters, which is those philanthropists who've zeroed in on think tanks and policy groups as the most high leverage way to give to affect what happens in government and what happens with public policy. Building institutions like on the right, the American Enterprise Institute or the Heritage Foundation, on the left, the Center for American Progress. There's a whole new donors network, the Democracy Fund of progressive funders. Just a tremendous amount of new money that's come into that public policy game, which in many ways is just political spending by another means with the advantage of being tax deductible.
Okay, so you're painting a picture. how does that power and clout they have compare to, over time, the power that government, the public sector has, that business has, that the nonprofit sector has? How is that evolving?
Well, so the big picture here is that philanthropy is rising at a moment that government is falling, really. Not to overstate, and that's not an overstatement. I think that long before Donald Trump came along with proposals to make draconian cuts in federal discretionary spending, that portion of the federal budget was already at the lowest level since the Eisenhower era. The Tea Party, which forced Obama to make cuts in discretionary spending, was actually quite effective in making a big hit on that part of the budget. And that trend, who's ever in the White House, this trend of government having fewer and fewer spare resources to try new things, to solve problems related to, you know, whether it's around environmental protection or fighting poverty or scientific or medical research, that portion of the budget is just going to keep being squeezed. And the picture, unfortunately, is the same at the state and local level, where pension obligations have been underfunded for many years. So state and local governments also have less spare resources. All this translates into greater pressures on philanthropists to kind of step in and meet some of these needs. We see this all the time. You see it at the local level with cities facing budgetary crises that philanthropists step forward to solve. You've been seeing it, you know, since in the Trump era, you know, as philanthropists have been stepping forward to, like, the global gag rule, just to give you one example. That Trump reinstated the global gag rule, big hit on family planning organizations in developing countries. The Gates Foundation has stepped forward to help plug that gap along with other funders. We're going to be seeing more of that, of government pulling back, philanthropy stepping forward, and with that largesse comes influence, comes power.
Is that a good thing?
I don't think in the aggregate it is a good thing. On the one hand, you're very want to be very thankful to these funders. I have a section in my book about Jim and Marilyn Simons, who have been harnessing a great hedge fund fortune to invest in basic science research. Very important stuff at a time, particularly at a time when the National Science Foundation has seen its budget go down in real terms. On the other hand, it's disturbing that you need billionaires to ensure that our society spends enough time, enough resources on science. And we see this in higher education. We see this in the arts. I look in my book on public universities, where there's been a disinvestment over the past couple decades in public state universities. And philanthropists have stepped forward to provide more and more resources to these institutions, and in doing so have come to have more and more control over those institutions. I like the idea of living in a society where we as citizens collectively have the resources to solve our problems, and government is a vibrant agent to do that. In the 20th century, philanthropy tended to be the kind of junior partner to government. You know, philanthropy played a very important role in kind of developing pilot projects, and, you know, there was important public-private partnerships, but it was always the sort of the junior partner. And the 20th century was a period when government was the kind of most powerful agent of change in our society. And I think the 21st century is going to see a kind of reversal of that, where government is going to be struggling more and more just to meet its existing obligations, and philanthropy is sort of going to slide in to the driver's seat of American life.
So let's keep breaking this down. You could go as far as to say that philanthropy sort of threatens civic equality and democracy. Would you go that far?
I would, because I think that the idea of civic equality and democracy is that all citizens have the same voice in public life. And of course, we know that if you're a savvy philanthropist, you can have a much greater voice, exponentially greater voice than the average citizen. You can wield a, you know, powerful megaphone, and, you know, we tend to cheer those philanthropists who do that in ways that we like, and be alarmed by the philanthropists who do that in ways we don't like. So the left always complains about the Kochs, and the right complains about George Soros. And I call that a la carte alarmism. You kind of zap the side you don't like, and when in fact it's all kind of it all raises some big questions about, you know, how do we protect civic equality at a time when there's a increasingly active, incredibly wealthy slice of super citizens at the top of the income ladder who are getting better and better at converting their wealth into policy influence across issue area after issue area.
So if we can't, I'm just going to keep pushing on this. If you can't sort of like turn back time, and you can't necessarily put the government back at the level of funding it was before, is this all bad? Has it got some good? Has it got some bad?
It absolutely has some good. I mean, as I point out in the book, the philanthropy is coming along in a way in the nick of time in order to provide public goods that government is unable increasingly to provide. On the other hand, the kind of downsizing of government did not happen by accident. As I detail in the book, conservative philanthropists invested billions of dollars to try to push a libertarian, small government, low tax ideology to bring a set of ideas from the fringe of the right during the 1970s and bring those ideas into the very center of public policy debates. They've been very effective. They have scaled up an infrastructure for pushing that ideology, not just at the national level, but at the state level as well. There are dozens and dozens of state-level think tanks that are kind of mini heritage foundations that are pushing that same thing. We now have the majority of states that are controlled by Republican governors and legislatures. And so it's not like, I mean, granted, I also make the obvious point that we have massive entitlement costs due to the demographic pressures of a retiring baby boom generation. But, you know, it is not like government just sort of organically lost its capacity to solve problems and be an agent of change for citizens. It was actually attacked over a series of decades, and that attack was in part heavily financed by wealthy people on the right.
So there's an equally sort of documented or fairly well-known case that the advance of marriage equality was definitely, so depending on your politics,
right,
depending on who's sitting out here tonight, you might say the story you just told, they were happy, some of them might be happy about that, and or be happy about marriage equality. So
right.
does it sort of depend on your politics?
Well, as I say, a la carte alarmism, or a la carte, or you know, or cheering the right. So in my Paul's referring to my book, I describe the incredibly effective philanthropy of LGBT rights donors. Tim Gill, most notably. Tim Gill made his money in technology, built a company called Quark, sold it for $400 million, put a bunch of that money into the Gill Foundation, which became the kind of nerve center of the LGBT rights movement, and particularly the kind of field marshal for the marriage equality movement. Very strategic and savvy effort to move that agenda, move it through the courts, through litigation, you know, popularize it through activism and advocacy. They were very effective. And if you believe in LGBT rights, this is a great case study of philanthropy. On the other hand, if you're a Christian evangelical living in a conservative state, you may be thinking like that went too fast, and this should have been something that was deliberated more by citizens, not sort of pushed through the courts by effective litigation backed by wealthy donors. I also point out in the book, you know, another example that I like is Michael Bloomberg, who became the largest ever donor to the Sierra Club. He has given $130 million to bankroll the Sierra Club's Beyond Coal movement, which has sought to shut down coal-fired plants around the country. It's been extremely effective in doing so. Hooray, hooray, I think, as somebody who is worried about climate change, I might have a different opinion if I worked in a coal mine or worked in the coal industry. I'd be like, what is this Manhattan billionaire financing all these lawyers to run around and shut down, you know, put my way of life out of business?
So let me sort of like take a different angle on it. There's also there's an evolution of how much the private sector corporations as an actor is sort of evolved in community work and in collective work and in a lot of things, ways you could cheer that. One of the most classic example of that is Salesforce. Mark Benioff, sort of known to be a pretty benevolent, pretty philanthropic CEO. They have a policy as a company that says they're going to give 1% of revenue, 1% of time, and 1% of something else away. And they've been doing that for many, many years, and they sort of become a role model for...
Product,
thank you. That's it. They become a role model for sort of lots of technology companies. Is that all good? Do you see something mixed about that? Is that mostly good? How does that compare to sort of how you feel about the power of philanthropy?
Well, I mean, that to me, that's a great thing. Mark Benioff has been a visionary leader, maybe the most important person in tech philanthropy in many ways, because he did have this, has been a proselytizer for this model of, you know, as he puts it, you know, business exists to improve the world. Yep. And he actually, before he started Salesforce, he had been at Oracle, and he was thinking, maybe I'll take the money I made at Oracle and go just be a philanthropist. And then he thought, you know, I have a better idea. I'll create a business that really fuses in philanthropy from the beginning. And that 1+1+1 model has lately been exploding in, like, they have taken that. Benioff and the Salesforce Foundation has taken that idea and really promoted it out there. And there are now, I think, over 1,000 tech startups or early stage tech companies which have pledged to give 1% of their equity to, or have taken some portion of that 1+1+1. To me, that's a very exciting thing. And a lot of that, those resources go to more traditional charitable causes. Mark Benioff has not been somebody who's engaged in this kind of activist policy philanthropy. He's given big money to hospitals in San Francisco. Salesforce has done a lot to help schools in that city, and it's inspiring.
So I want to keep sort of breaking down different sort of parts of this, of what you analyze in the book. There's another vehicle that some of you know about, some of you don't, called the Donor Advised Fund, which is, whether it's a community foundation or Fidelity or Schwab, folks can sort of decide, I want to be charitable, and plop a chunk of money into it. You get the tax write-off, and you can sort of let it sit there for a while. Then you make donor advised contributions out of those funds. But they're a little more anonymous. You can sort of park it there a little bit longer. Some folks think DAFs, DAFs are great. Some folks think DAFs, DAFs are not a good thing. Where do you sort of sort out on that? Where does that fit into the whole equation?
Well, DAFs are kind of a example of the bad news, or the good news, bad news of our modern philanthropic era, in the sense that DAFs have dramatically democratized philanthropy, right? 185,000 DAFs have been created in the last 15 years. I mean, this has exploded. People love these vehicles because, you know, instead of setting up a foundation where there's a lot of paperwork and compliance rules, and you got to file taxes, and you got to, you know, you just create a fund at either a community foundation or a financial, many of the financial companies now have DAFs, and they do all the work for you, and they cut the checks. You can have a very small, a lot of the DAFs are quite small. You know, people have small amounts of money. And so it's led to this explosion of small donors making small gifts often. And that's all great. The downside is that DAFs are part of what I call this new shadow giving system, which is that there is kind of a growing array of institutions, DAFs, other kinds of intermediaries, where money is flowing and you don't know who's giving it. So with DAFs, you can see where the money goes through grants, but you don't know who's giving it. So the Silicon Valley Community Foundation is like the go-to place for these tech rich tech people in Silicon Valley. And they gave away $1.2 billion last year, which is a record amount of money and makes them literally 10 times bigger than the nearest other biggest community foundation. But, and they say where all that money went, but they don't say who gave it. So me, as a journalist, I'm like, where'd all this money come from? I know Mark Zuckerberg parks his money there and some other people, but, and I think that's pretty alarming. You know, I'm a big believer that transparency is important in this sector, and particularly at a time when there is so much uneasiness about this new, keep in mind, all this new philanthropy by these wealthy people is coming at a time when the public is already extremely uneasy about the amount of power that the wealthy have in our society. So survey after survey shows that people feel the wealthy have too much power, people feel that their own voice doesn't count enough, and now we're seeing all these super citizens appear throwing around their money in ways both good or bad depending upon your politics at a time of that anxiety. We live in a populist moment, and I think that the last thing that we need is a lot more of this money flowing in non-transparent ways, because that just kind of increases the paranoia of who are these people, you know.
So we'll get to this in a minute. I'm going to assume you don't think the best idea is for them to just sort of give it back.
Who, the wealthy people?
Yeah.
to give the money back?
Yeah.
Well, in effect, that's what many of them say that they're going to do. I mean, Mark Zuckerberg and Priscilla Chan are pledged to give away 99% of their Facebook stock. And that's kind of a solution to inequality, right? Just give it back. Interestingly, though, that announcement produced tremendous sort of pushback by people who felt like, hey, that's too much power in the hands of a 30-year-old couple, right? They had 45, at the time they made that announcement, they had $45 billion. Now they have $60 billion. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, I would rather see a society with less concentration of wealth at the top. And, you know, we've gotten all these vast fortunes have not just magically appeared because of technology and globalization. They've also appeared because we've had public policies friendly to the owners of capital that have made it easy to accumulate this kind of wealth. And in particular, we've had very low taxes on capital gains, which are taxed at a lower rate than income. And those policies, in part, were engineered by earlier generations of philanthropists who backed places like Heritage and Cato and AEI to make those arguments. And so I would rather live in a society where there's less wealth at the top and more wealth available for we as citizens to spend through government solving our problems together.
So in a minute, we're going to get to sort of what you think we might do to correct some of this. And by the way, I'm going to throw questions open here in a couple of minutes, so get your brains going. Do you think, sort of along those lines, do you think expanding avenues for giving by folks sort of like all of us in this room, you know, sort of lower down the income stream, is expanding, and there's more crowdfunding, there's GoFundMe, there's way more ways for people at the bottom of the pyramid, like all of us, to give.
Yeah.
Does that help sort of ameliorate this power?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, if you, and a lot of these crowdsourcing, for those who don't follow the field very closely, there's a whole bunch of new platforms for enabling small donors to give easily, and that has a lot of promise. One way I think of it is if you think of how campaign finance reformers have sought to get have approached reforming money in politics, it's sort of been a dual track strategy, which is they've tried to get the big money out and bring more little donors in. So public financing of campaigns matches small donors and efforts to help people make it easier for people to vote, get more citizens engaged, while trying to regulate, trying to limit the amount that individuals can give to elect politicians. Unfortunately, that strategy has encountered some obstacles, like with the Supreme Court, Citizens United, for example. But I think it's an approach that we need to think about in philanthropy. You know, how do we sort of try to limit the influence of the biggest donors and get more people in? In terms of how to do that in a regulatory way, it's a very complex problem. So I don't. My book is more of a problem book than a solution book. So sometimes solution books, by the way, you know, you'll read books and it's all about like, here's my big solution, and 300 pages of the details of how exactly my solution would work. Problem books are, here's the problem, and then at the end there's a chapter of, oh, here's some ideas, you know. So my book is a problem book, which I say just as a disclaimer. So you're not—it's not the comprehensive blueprint for what to do.
I'm gonna push you on it a little bit. One more question, and then if folks have questions, either get your hands up or head over to the microphones. We'd love to hear from what's on your minds out here. So if I sort of gave you a choice between, sort of like, I don't know, change the tax system so more of that wealth back went back in the government versus modify how they give away their philanthropy. Some people would argue that private citizens or sort of, you know, individual philanthropists are going to be more effective or more efficient at solving problems than the government was, right? That's an argument. So would you say that, do you want more of that money to go back in the government, or do you want them to change how they have to spend that money?
That's a good question. I don't necessarily believe that it's an either-or thing. I think you could have higher capital gains taxes and more labor regulation to ensure a better sharing of the economic pie and get less inequality, and that would produce, you know, smaller fortunes at the very top. There'd still be a lot of money at the very top, and so I think that we need to think about how do you regulate how do you impose more rules? The last time we really regulated, Congress took a close look at regulating philanthropy was in 1969, almost 50 years ago. A lot has changed since then. And one of the main things that's changed is the explosion of this whole infrastructure for policy and advocacy and litigation funded by wealthy donors and foundations to influence public policy. And I think that we now need to take another look at the regulatory regime around philanthropy with an eye toward asking, you know, do we want to kind of limit the amount of money that can go to that stuff and try to direct more money to efforts on the ground in communities to really help people. I do think that philanthropists have the capacity to do things that government cannot, and give descriptions of that in my book in detail, which is philanthropy is good at taking risks. It's good at experimentation. It's good at tackling long-term problems. Government is not good at any of those things. And so you want some money outside of the tight oversight of that is not account. I mean, one of the great things about philanthropy is that philanthropists are not accountable to voters, and they're not accountable to shareholders, and they can operate with more freedom and move in a more flexible and nimble fashion. Those are positive traits. But they can also be scary traits when they play out in spaces that we as citizens deem to be, you know, very sort of almost sacred democratic spaces, like education. You know, public education is a place where citizens historically have viewed as like, this is one of the most democratic spheres of life. And to have all these sort of wealthy donors and foundations come into that space with so many superior resources has produced a fair amount of alarm and backlash. And I think that we'll be seeing more of that writ large in our society going forward.
Okay. All right, y'all. What's on your minds out there? Who's got a question? Who's got a thought? Walk on up, and we'd love to hear you. Why don't you give us a name and a question, if you would, please.
Sure. Barb Weber, and I wanted to start with an acknowledgement to thank you both. And as I said to David before the talk tonight, I'm just a voracious consumer of what you're writing, so thank you for doing it, and please keep at it. And Paul, you've been such an important torchbearer in Seattle for these last two decades. And your work just recently, I just want to particularly around advocating for unrestricted funding.
Thanks.
And, you know, there are so many who struggle day to day with the reality of what those constraints mean. And when someone of your stature throws their authority and, weight into the conversation. People are able to use that. It means a lot.
Thanks.
So
we'll have dinner afterwards.
Okay. I've seen it, though, so I know it's true. I guess if I had to come with a couple of questions, I'd love to hear you both speak to. You talked a little bit about donor advised funds and just this whole phenomenon right now around the kind of the warehousing of wealth, you know, and the parking it as people, as living donors, are continuing to, engage in their lives in a variety of ways, and philanthropy being only one of them. Of course, there are merits to being thoughtful. But as you were saying, there's this trend of all these donor advised funds sort of amassing these fortunes. And in the meantime, there are all these urgent crises and things that are calling out for action and support. So if you were having dinner with some of your friends who have large fortunes that aren't currently being deployed or directed to social purpose, what would you say to them? What might be that conversation over dinner? And I guess the other question I'd have would be, as impact investing is gaining so much cachet right now, Catherine Gill was here in Seattle in November. I don't know if anyone else was at that impact investing breakfast, but she said, it is a legitimate concern that impact investing is cannibalizing philanthropy, that money that might otherwise go to philanthropy is now just being repurposed, that it's not actually enlarging the pie, it's actually just diverting some of it. So could you speak a little bit about sort of the case for philanthropy and how you see the popularity of impact investing being a part of this?
Okay. You want to take the first one, take the second one?
Yeah, sounds like a deal.
Okay.
So this warehousing of wealth, it's kind of a complicated topic because if you talk to the advocates of donor advised funds, I was in a discussion with Emmett Carson, who runs the Silicon Valley Community Foundation. And his point is, our payout is much higher than 5%, the normal 5% foundation, that the money is. So for those who don't know, donor advised funds have no payout requirements. So you can put your money in, get the tax deduction, and it can sit there indefinitely. And that's raised a lot of alarms for good reasons, which is that, there's an expectation if you get a tax deduction that the money goes to charity. And with donor advised funds, there's no guarantee that that's going to happen anytime soon. So there's a lot of calls for reform. And the donor advised fund people push back, saying, oh, plenty of money is going out the door. Don't worry about it. Well, I think that as time goes on and as more of this wealth is warehoused, at a time, as you note, of urgent needs, that people's concerns about this are going to grow. And the broader context is these government cutbacks that I mentioned, that as the fiscal screws tighten more and more on government at all levels, people are going to, and as the amount of warehouse wealth grows more and more large, people are going to start taking a closer look at that warehoused wealth. In fact, it's happening already with college endowments. There's investigation going on right now in the U.S. Congress about those college endowments, and why is all this, Yale and Harvard sitting on these huge endowments when tuition keeps going up and up for students? And hey, can we get some of that warehouse wealth to provide some relief to these students who are going out in to start their careers with incredible amounts of debt? And I think that that same scrutiny is going to turn increasingly to DAFs and foundations. And also, I think that there's going to be more scrutiny to the charitable tax deduction, which is now exactly a century old. It was created in 1917, and its cost has continued to rise. It's now $40 or $50 billion that the Treasury loses every year. It's going to be about $750 billion over the next decade lost to the charitable tax deduction. Assumption has always been, this is good stuff. It's well worth it. We're getting a lot of bang from that, mm-hmm. from that tax break. But when we're losing $40 or $50 billion and kicking kids off Pell Grants and pulling Section 8 vouchers and cutting SNAP, people are going to say, well, wait a minute, is that $40 or $50 billion being deployed more effectively than we might use it to you know, keep people from losing their homes and keep people fed. And I think it's a legitimate question that the nonprofit sector needs to be able to address more persuasively than it's done to date.
And the only, the, if I had 30 seconds to add what David said on the first point, the evidence of what effective philanthropy looks like, we gave you two examples, marriage equality and conservative thought. And whether you like it or not, and I'm sure many people in this room don't like it, the way that the conservative movement got going was for the last 40 years, there have been a half a dozen foundations that were absolutely obsessed with it. They never quit. They stuck with it. They kept giving their money. They kept giving unrestricted funding. And it had an enormous impact. So if you want to have an impact with your philanthropy, focus, stick with it, give it unrestricted, and don't quit. To the point of impact investing, it's an interesting one. So for those folks that, so we sort of have a common definition of it, the notion of impact investing is that folks would make investments in for-profit social purpose organizations. And the line between exactly what defines that versus a regular for-profit is certainly a little blurry. But there's certainly companies out there that, you know, they're a for-profit that thinks that's their best way to invest in energy or something about the environment. And one distinction to understand is that nonprofit for-profit's not a mission thing. That's a capital decision. What's the kind of capital I want to fuse my enterprise? So I can be an evil nonprofit and I can be a virtuous for-profit very easily. So there's this whole movement called impact investing. That's true. There's this whole movement called impact investing, which is about making investments in for-profit companies that have a social purpose. And your comment, I'll give you an honest answer. I think there's a little bit of zero-sumness to it in the sort of anecdotal evidence that I've seen locally. And if you sort of look at the broader data, for the most part, not totally, for the most part, I think it's growing the pie, not shrinking it. Now, you know, in certain sort of slices of the pie, is it taking away from some philanthropy? It would have to be. But in general, it's another form of capital sort of directed at another kind of organization. It does bring in some donors that otherwise would say, hey, I don't want to do philanthropy, but I'll do this. And I do think for the most part, what I've seen folks, I do see some folks that redirect some of their philanthropy, but I will tell you anecdotally, I see a lot of individuals that I think sort of, you know, they have their philanthropy bucket and their regular investing bucket, and they sort of have some funds they've dragged into this impact investing space that they otherwise would not have. So not a perfect story. I think on the whole, positive, growing the pie, and it's a different slice that we didn't have before. That's in one person's opinion. So great question. Please.
Hi, I'm Margaret Friedman, and that was very interesting. In a darker vein, I'm guessing that I'm not the only one in the room who read the Evan Osnos article about the super rich buying luxury condominiums that are located in repurposed nuclear missile silos. there's a growing bunker mentality among these, you know, a certain constituency of billionaires, and that reminded me of our local wonderful billionaire who is speaking out quite a bit against that kind of behavior, Nick Hanauer, who believes that the pitchforks are not far away. I'm wondering if you can envision any sort of scenario of massive social unrest or civil war coming out of the degree of inequality that we are seeing now.
You know, that's a good question, and I did read Nick Hanauer's article about the pitchforks coming, which, by the way, was the most read article in Politico the year it was published. So apparently he had touched a vein with that piece. You know, I do think that one thing that I've noticed is that more and more of these wealthy people get that inequality is a problem. And it may be because they're worried about the pitchforks. It may be because they're worried about the fate of our democracy. And it may be, many of them I know are very worried about the fate of these low-income kids in particular. And, you know, I've just been struck by how many wealthy people, how many of these billionaires are engaged in philanthropy today compared to, say, 30 years ago. I mean, think of like when Bonfire of the Vanities was published in the 1980s, and sort of Sherman McCoy was the archetype of the master of the universe of this kind of 80s greed is good, go-go moment. And, you know, Gordon Gekko, sort of an icon of that era. And that's not the that is not as much the ethos. Today, Sherman McCoy would have like a foundation that supported inner city kids, right? You know, the billionaires who've been involved in charter schools and education have gotten so much criticism for pushing like a pro-market agenda. On the other hand, I think, you know, since when do billionaires care, like when did billionaires start to care about kids of color in the inner cities? I mean, that is sort of a remarkable turn, and I think that it partly reflects people's anxieties that this inequality is unsustainable. Unfortunately, it is not also translated into, by the way, and I track, have written quite a bit about the growing number of wealthy donors on the left in the last 10 or 15 years. Many more liberal billionaire types have emerged as donors, Nick Hanauer being one of them, but there's a bunch of others. And so I think that there is some anxiety. Many of these people do get it. Unfortunately, not enough of them get it, and that many of them also are like working at odds with themselves. So one donor who will remain unnamed here, you know, has been a big donor. His foundation gives tremendously to help poor kids in the inner city with social services and education, charter schools, and the like, hospitals, low-income services. He also gave $5 million to the Trump campaign, electing a president who's now proposing the most draconian cuts ever in discretionary federal spending that will hit all those same kids. So.
Yeah, I question the interpretation as positive of the kinds of philanthropy that you're talking about, because unless the philanthropy actually goes to changing the system that enabled it, I can imagine a jaundiced reception.
Well, yeah, and I point that out. You know, as it turns out, the big beneficiaries of our economic status quo are not particularly keen to upend that status quo. They're the winners.
Good question. Next. Go.
Hi, Mark Crowell. I have a question about how much of the total charitable giving in a given year is given by the top 1%?
That's a good question. And I don't know the answer, but I believe it would be, so in the most recent year, there's about $375 billion in giving. And of that, do you have this statistic on hand?
If you're going to make me guess, I'm going to say the top 1% give 20% of that number.
Yeah, probably 20 or 30%,
yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah,
but
like that.
What's significant is that the share of gifts, giving by the wealthy has been going up while giving by the rest of Americans has been going down. So there was a study that came out a few months ago that showed that households with assets of more than $10 million have, since 2003, more than doubled the amount of the gifts that they're making, and households with assets of under $100,000 had reduced their gifts by like 8% or something. There are some questions about the methodology, but the findings totally make sense, which is that almost all of the income gains over the past 15 years have gone to the top 1%, and everybody else has either been running in place or has actually lost ground, particularly with the Great Recession. So it would be no wonder if, you know, more of the giving was coming from the top. And one problem with that, and we just recently wrote about this at Inside Philanthropy, looking particularly at higher education, where there's been a surge of big $10 million plus gifts and a kind of fall off of alumni, average alumni giving. A problem with that is that the wealthy donors are increasingly kind of calling the shots within civil society. It's kind of a hollowing out of the nonprofit sector with the wealthy, with more fundraisers chasing the wealthy, not even bothering as much with the ordinary donors. I compare it to like these, I fly across the country a lot, and the airlines in the last 5 years have changed, like half the plane is now first class seats, and then, you know, there's a few rows in the back for everybody else, right? And that sort of reflects our economy, which it makes more sense for American Airlines to sell those really expensive, devote half the plane to those really expensive seats, and it makes more sense for fundraisers to go after those big fish, and in turn, those big fish increasingly call the shots within nonprofits.
A follow-on question, if I could. What's the likely impact of a repeal of the death tax on charitable giving?
There have been some studies that suggest it would have a big impact. So the estate tax is one, as I mentioned, is an incentivizer for these wealthy to give because they don't want to see the government, God forbid, get its hands on their fortunes. And so if you get rid of the estate tax, there are various projections that have been done that it would have a negative impact. On the other hand, I should point out that many other countries that have gotten rid of the charitable tax deduction saw like a drop-off of giving, but then giving continued to go up with personal income. So it's unclear to the degree to which tax policy really is a key driver here.
Yep. You can get arguments on both sides of it. There's a guy at Boston College, his name's Paul Shoemaker. He's incredibly thoughtful about why people give, and he says it wouldn't make any difference. I find that hard to believe, but there's plenty of evidence that says it won't be a massive effect, but it would have some effect.
Well, most Americans don't get a tax deduction because right. They don't itemize their taxes. So right. The vast majority of that $375 billion that's given for charity, people do not get a deduction for that.
Right. How about over here?
Hey, thank you for having this conversation. It's been a really good one. I find that I personally am a bit contradictory in my own philanthropy and my own giving. Dressed in a gown, going to a $500 a plate fundraiser for the Fred Hutch that raises a few million dollars in an evening. But on the way getting there, I'm driving past people living in tents next to the freeway. And I think all of us probably hit that same thing. But I'm wondering, as you were talking about some of these foundations, the Heritage and whomever, if indeed those are the most effective ways to spend money, like you mentioned with marriage equality, is what we see as philanthropy doing when you started at the beginning of your talk is we're actually putting our fingers in the dike, right? As government is contracting and so philanthropy is required and it continues and continues, is if the real change to put the giving and the sharing of money should go back into the government and be more democratic, is that where we should be applying our money? Is to the lawyers that go and seek changes in tax or to make sure that we don't get fair start cut or head start cut, those sorts of things.
Right. Yeah, this is the reason that many philanthropists are drawn to public policy is because they want to look upstream and to stop the cuts from being made, or in some cases, accelerate the cuts to be made. But they know that, you know, government remains the big actor with the most resources, and if you can influence what government does, you can have a huge impact. And, you know, I was having a conversation with the foundation president in Los Angeles, and you know, she was saying, we're really concerned about college access and making sure that low-income kids can go to college. And, you know, therefore we give scholarship money to low-income kids go to college from Los Angeles. And I said, well, what about the fact that tuition at the UC system has gone up from a few hundred dollars a year to, you know, thousands and thousands of dollars a year? Are you working on that problem? She was like, "Oh no, that's advocacy," and maybe she shouldn't be working on that problem because that's not how we don't want money to intervene in those debates. But under current law and the way things are, if I were a philanthropist, that's where I would be focusing. You know, big time philanthropy. That's where, in fact, to the degree I give money, I give to think tanks, right? Yeah, I mean, I spent 15 years building a think tank and co-founded a think tank, so I have a dog in that race. But I was into think tanks for the exact reason of this is as I said, the chapter in my book on the donors who give to think tanks is called Grand Masters, right? Because they're playing the game at this meta level of if you can control the narrative around the role of government and around how much resources government can extract from society through taxes and then redeploy to social provision, if you can kind of command that conversation through think tanks and investments and policy and ideas and messaging and journalism and advocacy, then like that is so much more effective than operating downstream, you know.
Given scholarship.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And the problem is it's so effective, it's scary, and that that wealthy philanthropists are able to operate at that level in a way, by the way, that most Americans can't even kind of comprehend. They have no, most people don't know what think tanks are and barely know what philanthropy is, and to the extent that they do know what philanthropy is, they think of it as charitable gifts to museums and hospitals and social service organizations and universities. They don't think, oh, philanthropy is, you know, well, I'll give you a dramatic example of philanthropy in recent years, which is after the Affordable Care Act was passed, a number of conservative philanthropists invested heavily in litigation to try to destroy it. That litigation resulted in two cases that reached the Supreme Court. One of them knocked out the mandate for mandatory Medicaid provision. And so 20 states did not expand Medicaid as a result of that. That's highly, and 8 million people ended up not getting insurance because of the highly strategic philanthropy of a handful of these conservative funders.
Let's do one more question over here. By the way, if you went to the gala, it's good. Don't feel guilty. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Adrian. Thank you for talking with us. I have kind of a sloppy question, so hopefully it comes out appropriately.
Sloppy question? Mm-hmm,
okay. In the sense that it covers a lot of topics and probably won't be well spoken, but hopefully you'll be able to respond to it anyway. So this is in regard to the Grand Masters, and as you said, philanthropists that don't want to work against the mechanisms that have garnered them their power. Here we go. I had to write it down because it's a it's a big one for me, but it's probably pretty simple for you. So with the attack on the government and the rise of free market society, combined with an incomplete form of capitalism that aggregates wealth in the hands of the few, alongside technology that decreases options for individual market participation, are there philanthropists giving to efforts that are contrary to the imbalanced mechanisms that have garnered them power? And I'd like to exclude bigger government from that list of solutions. And what are they?
That's a sloppy question at all. That's a good
So philanthropists who want to rein in our current form of extreme capitalism and
or have alternatives to it.
Yeah.
And if you've heard any alternatives to it or strategies against
And this goes back to the earlier question about the pitchforks coming, mm-hmm. and philanthropists are concerned about this. So in my previous book, I had a chapter entitled "What's the Matter with Connecticut," which is about wealthy donors who give to liberal causes to try to, you know, address income inequality. And it's interesting, as I said, there have been more of them. One of the ones that I look at in my book is a guy named Herb Sandler, who made his money in the savings and loan industry over 40 years, and then during the Bush era became very concerned about rising inequality and the kind of extremist politics of the right and the kind of what he saw as the perverse nature of capitalism that allowed for so much exploitation. And so he invested in a number of progressive organizations to try to combat inequality, and one of them is a place called the Center for Responsible Lending, which has really tried to challenge the financial services industry in all of its predatory ways and help people, low-income people, build wealth and help communities build wealth through community, all kinds of community investments and keeping wealth in communities. So to the degree that people are thinking about an alternative, a lot of that energy is focused on, can you help communities build wealth and control, have control and not be at the whim of multinational corporations and big and predatory financial institutions. And there's a lot of interesting stuff happening there now.
Yeah, that was a very unsloppy question.
Thank you.
Thanks. Let me ask you one more question. I'll give you a sort of one to end us on. So you've sort of given us a scale with both sides of it. What are a couple of the things that turn this greater wealth, whether it's a good thing or not, what creates an opportunity? What are a couple of things that can happen, that can be done, that could make this sort of greater wealth more of an opportunity than it is a risk? Give us one or sort of two solutions.
Right. Well, one thing that can happen is for philanthropists themselves to change their norms and to be more mindful of their power. And there's a lot happening right now with philanthropy foundations, particularly thinking about how do we listen more to the communities that we serve and want to help. Because it's one thing to swoop in with a set of top-down ideas that you know best. It's another thing to go into a community and spend some time listening and ask people, like, what do you really need to solve your problems and how can we help you? And more philanthropists are getting to understand that if they really want to have impact, they do need to listen and that the top-down thing doesn't work. And I'll just give you one sort of encouraging example, which is, after Mark Zuckerberg gave $100 million for New Work, there was a tremendous criticism of that effort because it was perceived as top-down, and Mark Zuckerberg took a lot of heat. And most people don't know the rest of the story, which is that Mark Zuckerberg and his wife Priscilla Chan absorbed the lessons of that episode and came to realize that, they did need to be effective, they would need to listen more. And a few years later, they made a bigger gift to improve education, which barely got any attention, but was for $120 million and went to Silicon Valley schools, and has involved all the stakeholders there. And when I interviewed Priscilla Chan for this book, she said to me, I know all the leaders in the schools that we're giving to. She talks to them and hears from them, and they're all at the table. This is not about... So that whole, and I think more broadly in education, that kind of technocratic charter school, we're going to come in and blow up the system and rebuild it from the scratch with the help of a bunch of 28-year-old McKinsey consultants, I think that that's losing traction among philanthropists who realize that you need more inclusive strategies. So, that's part of the solution. It's just some real shifting of norms here. And hopefully that can happen fast enough before we really do get a strong populist reaction there could be a kind of overcorrection here, which is a kind of real kind of society coming down hard on philanthropy and throwing the baby out with the bathwater if we go too far. So I would not like to see that. And what I've been trying to do with my book is start this, try to move this conversation up a notch and particularly say to the people in the philanthropy sector, you guys got to get ahead of the curve here. If you think that the populist juggernaut or the accountability movement is not going to one day show up at your doorstep and that this sort of you operating with all this power, often in secrecy, is not going to produce a backlash, then you have not read recent American history, right? And so, get ahead of the curve and adjust your own behavior and embrace some reforms and shift norms and culture you know, that's really what needs to be mm-hmm. done to make sure this remains. People have called philanthropy, you know, America's best invention, you know, best idea, more so than the national parks. And it is a great thing, but it needs to be a force in our society that is compatible with our democratic and egalitarian ideals.
You made a couple comments in the book about transparency, accountability, I thought were good. I love that. I think that's a really, it's early, it's nascent, but the notion of and the word philanthropy sucks, by the way, too. But the notion of sort of philanthropically minded people actually listening to people in the community, getting more on the ground, there is something really positive about that. It's early, it's nascent, it's really positive. I like that answer. I want to thank everybody here, first of all, for showing up and bringing great questions. You gave us some great energy in the room. Thank you very, very much. And thank you for coming to town and sharing your ideas and making us all think tonight. So thanks, David.
Thank you, Paul.